This topic focuses mainly on locust and the population of locust. Now, locust has been affecting India and the various regions of India badly. We have seen sudden increase in the population of locust with the unusual rainfall that occurred, and that has increased the proportion of locust. Now, Locust Warning Organization, which is run by the Ministry of Agriculture and Family Welfare, is one of the oldest national locust monitoring system. It is believed that nearly 50,000 hectares of cotton crop has been destroyed because of the infestation that has been caused mainly in the regions of Rajasthan, Haryana, Madhya Pradesh and the regions of Maharashtra. Now, this is the ground zero, as you can see, and this was basically the epicenter of this locust plague, and slowly and gradually it is spread to other regions across India. Now, this has been reported by the Food and Agricultural Organization. Now, we have seen that this locust has been one of our ancient enemies. Since 1810, we have Bengal, which has been affected severely because of it. In 1869, you had Rajasthan, which suffered huge losses. You had huge swarms, which have affected the regions in India and the regions of the Northwest Province and also the regions of Pakistan. Now, it's believed, where is the center? So, you have the epicenter, which is seen in the regions of Ethiopia, and slowly and gradually you have the movement that occurs across this whole region. So those marked in the red are the most vulnerable areas, and because of the increasing global warming, you have multiple breeding seasons that are seen, and the cycle has further elongated for these locusts. And this migration is further interesting. Now, if we look onto the migration, what happens is during the winter and the spring months, this is the migration towards India. However, you have a resulting migration that occurs after summers and which is back towards the regions of Africa. And there is another loop that is seen in the Western Africa, which is within the regions of the African territory. Now, these desert locusts are known for cannibalism, because when they get food, they eat the food, but in case they are not able to get a sufficient amount of food, they are extremely hungry. They would start eating their own species or the members that are flying in front of them. So therefore, they also depict cannibalism, which is again very, very important. Now, to kill a locust, you need to have 4 to 5 times higher level of insecticides that are used. In India, we have seen some of the important developments where drones are used to spray insecticides in order to curb the proportion of locusts. Now, some of the important chemicals that have been used are chloroprifos. Now, this is a kind of organophosphate. It basically affects the nervous pathway and breaks the chemical action that is there, and it causes inability to communicate. As a result, it is affecting the locust population, but it is also harmful to the aquatic life because it ultimately drains into the water systems and the agricultural levels. Lambda cyclorethine is another group of pyrenoids, and this is causing toxicity in human beings. It causes skin, throat and eye irritation. The next is melathion. Now, melathion is a recognized insecticide and pesticide that's there, but it is highly toxic to earthworms, honeybees and leads to soil contamination. It can be absorbed through all roots in human beings, and it is again a derivative or a organophosphate. Now, what are the biocontrol methods? Biocontrol is firstly the locust pheromones that are released. You have phenyl acetonitrile. Both of these basically curb the adult swarms. They also lead to the reduced behavior for adult males. However, they increase solitary tendencies in the young ones, and therefore it basically creates the chain of locusts that is there. The next is metahyrazine acidurum. This is where you have spores of fungus that are seen, and it penetrates into the body of insects. You have another pesticide, which is a biopesticide, which has been declared by the International Institute for Tropical Agriculture. However, you have BHC and dihedrine, which has been, the usage has been stopped by the Locust Warning Center, considering these are highly harmful. Now, neem is again used as an alternative because the spray of the neem over the plants creates a protective layer, and it creates a chemicals which are similar to the structure of the locust's own hormones. And as a result, the endocrine system gets blocked, which brings a change in the physiology. The next is the SpaceX mission, where you are trying, the private missions, private company is trying to land human beings to space for the first time inside a bullet-shaped automated spacecraft, which is known as Crew Dragon. So Crew Dragon has been designed to take people to and from the International Space Station. So again, an important mission where we are trying to bring in settlement in Mars. Not only that, space tourism is a new sort of business that could evolve. In India, we have seen technically nearly 70% higher rainfall than the normal in the first week of June itself. The central India has received nearly 157% higher normal rainfall, and the northwest India around 115% more rainfall than normal. As per the IMD's prediction, this is because of the cyclone Nisarg that had entered. The next is antibiotics. Now, antibiotics and its use in animals has been significantly affected. The Food Safety Standards Authority of India has tested various milk samples and has detected 77 samples with antibiotic residues. However, they have not been disclosed. But there have been case-by-case studies. For example, Amul, there have been no residues that have been seen for the use of antibiotics. There are other vendors where you have the use that has been seen. Metastasis is a common disease which is seen mostly in the cattle, and the best way is to clean the organ, clean the floor after the organism, after the cow or the milk is being extracted. And this is where you have the hygiene maintenance, which is very, very important. So dry cow therapy is one of the major ways to prevent the various diseases. Now, what are the common diseases that affect the cattle is again important. India is one of the largest milk producers, and most of the milk is consumed in the urban areas, nearly 52% of it, and 80% comes through the cooperatives. Now, what are the rampant antibiotics that are used? The list of those are given here, and the effects on human beings are seen here. So it's very, very important to see if there is rampant use or misuse, we could say, of antibiotics in cattle, which would ultimately go into the human systems. So how we need to tackle it is, we need to categorize for what treatment what antibiotic has to be given. For example, penicillin is recommended for anthrax and black water. However, streptomycin is recommended for bovine TB that is there. Also, you have bacterial resistance that is seen significantly. Cow and buffalo dung is used as a manure, and therefore has brought in a reservoir of antimicrobial resistance causing determinants into the system. So as we said, you have various case studies that are done. Now, of these case studies, you have Nandini, which is a kind of milk federation from Karnataka, where milk is tested once in 6 months. Some of the dairies like Mother Dairy Gopalji have not responded to it. Now, misuse, as we said, is a big issue, and preventing the animal from this misuse is again very, very important. So the Food Safety Corporation of India has set the tolerance limit for various antibiotics, mainly the gentamicin, ceftriaxone, and then you have amoxicillin. So those are the antibiotics where you have most of the tolerance limits that are being set. And it is further recommended that over-the-counter sales should be curbed and no antibiotics should be given without prescription. The next is the gas leakage that has produced a fire in the regions of Assam. Now, you have the Dibru-Sahakot National Park that is located, and most of the smoke was seen in this region. Now, this is the world's only riverine island that is seen where the fire broke off and affected the impacts have went in the rivers of Brahmaputra, Lohit and Dibru. You have what is the characteristic of this national park which is located here? It lies at the intersection of two of the world's 34 biodiversity hotspots, which are the Indo-Myanmar and the Eastern Himalayas. Numerous wetlands, which is associated with Dibru River, the list is given here. And again, you have certain endangered bird species, the list is given here, which are located there. The next is, we are talking about the drilling operations of the oil in this region, and you have BOPs, which is blowout preventers, which should be installed at the time of drilling operations, and this could be one of the major solutions that could be seen. Now, forest riots in the regions of Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh and Odisha have been affecting the forest dwellers and the forest communities here. So there have been various changes that have been brought about in the regions of Maharashtra, Odisha and Chhattisgarh. In Odisha, Tehsildar has been appointed as a forest settlement officer. In Chhattisgarh, forest department, the nodal agency, is the nodal agency which recognizes any kind of forest resource rights. And then in Maharashtra, you have a division level committee that would serve the people's grievances that are there. So there have been various dilution of the laws that have been seen. Now, Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change has talked about the coal-fired plants, and 60% of the industrial emissions, mainly in the form of particulate matter, 45% of sulfur dioxide and nearly 80% of the mercury emissions are seen here. These are resource-intensive units but are highly polluting industries, and India is expected to become one of the top sulfur dioxide emitters in the world as per a Maryland University study. So, what is required is implementation of norms to cut the emissions for particulate matter by 35%, sulfur dioxide by 80% and nitrogen oxides by 42% is very, very important. And old and outdated plants must be replaced. So what is the capacity before 2003, between 2004 and 2016 and after 2017 has been important, and how much share has been there with the private. So we have seen a significant jump in the private holders. The next is the virus effect. It has been spreading significantly, and India would have the largest number of new poor as per one of the researchers of World Bank because of this pandemic situation, and there are chances that this COVID virus would be present in the water cycle and make the poor and the marginalized people more vulnerable to the health risk. Also, it has been moving from the regions which are having a higher per capita income to the regions with low per capita income, and definitely it would affect a significant proportion of population present there. Now, Gavi is an international organization which has talked about millions of people which have missed the vaccination schedule because of either the postponement of the campaign or the interruption because of the lockdown phase, not only in India but across the globe. And this might lead to a domino effect that could be created, where when you are trying to follow up one, it brings in a cumulative effect for the other, and there could be series of new diseases which were not covered because of the vaccination that could further increase. So that is again a big concern. The next important aspect is Kachnar leaves. Now, Kachnar leaves are bilobed. It is similar to a butterfly wing. They are highly nutritious part of the legume family, rich in protein, and you have higher amount of calcium and iron that is seen. Usually by the Munda community, which is a tribal community, it is used mixing it with water for rehydration of the body, and it is used for food. It is also the second biggest source of food in the regions of Jharkhand. That is very, very important. So it is also known as Bahunia in the Latin, after the herbalist Johann and Gaspard Bahuni, who discovered actually this. This is found in the regions of India, China, Burma, Bhutan and Pakistan, and it has used, it is also seen in the national flag of Hong Kong and the coins of Hong Kong. However, the same plant in the regions of Cuba, Australia, Kenya, Rwanda is considered a weed and an invasive species. The unemployment scenario has been drastically increasing. As we have seen, there is a significant jump in the unemployment rate that has been registered. Climate changes have been responsible for the increase in the average temperatures across the globe. Human Genome Project was the first successful completion took place in 2003, where sequencing of the entire human genome, the 3.3 million base pairs have been done. And this is a complete set of DNA that is being studied, which includes all of its gene. And this leads to a significant landmark growth in the field of bioinformatics and bringing in data analysis for identification of the genome database. The next important is, what are the food habits that have changed? Nutritional food, safe food are considered important. The idea is to reduce carbon footprint and find out the most important emergence of the zoonosis, which is the diseases which are transmitted from animals to human beings, and the regions where they have been found out. So Nipah was initially seen in Malaysia and then is spread across to various countries. SARS and COVID originated from China. So those are some of the ways through which we believe the epidemics have originated. Now if we talk about the local production, we have various understanding of the various sources of the greenhouse gases. You have electricity, heat production, deforestation, industries, transport as some of the major factors that are leading to greenhouse gas emissions. If we talk about the crops, pearl millet is a significant high source of folate that is seen. You have sorghum and millet, which are considered as a smart food. Ragi has 3 times more calcium than milk. You have kodo millet, which is known for dietary fiber. So it's very, very important that we have consumption of not only the starchy food, but also food which is rich in the various nutrients and micronutrients. Biofortification has been increased significantly. ICAR, the Indian Council for Agricultural Research, has been working for maize varieties which has higher proportions of zinc and protein rich rice, which is being seen. Also you have fortified sorghums in the name of Prabhani Shakti, which are being developed and released into the market. Also we need to promote healthy and nutritional food, which is part of the National Nutrition Mission, through the public distribution system, the midday meals schemes and the integrated child development programs. Now if we talk about the conservation, we have either in situ or ex situ. In situ is within their natural environments, ex situ is outside their natural environments. And in the regions of Uttarakhand, you have Munsiyari town. Munsiyari town, you have a tulip garden, which is very well known, and germ plants, which are being protected here. Similarly, you have certain medicines, which is being extracted from the bark of Himalayan yew, which is used to cure various cancer diseases, and Vankakri, which is a local herb again used for cancers and detoxification of body and improving the kidney health. The next is, we are talking about the community policy, which is known as Thikri Fera. Now, farmers in Punjab and Haryana have turmeric farming, and similar turmeric farming is also seen in the regions of Kandamal district in Odisha, where you have the GI tag for turmeric that is being seen. Now, these are some of the major regions where you have the developments that have been seen, and we need to review the existing urban policies in line of providing more workplace opportunities to the migrants and providing a kind of distress-free environment for even the people in the low and the marginalized sections of the society. So it's very important to have a development through various community policing and keeping pressure onto the administrative systems for better functioning of these policies. So with this, we cover major highlights. As we said, locust, the spread of locust, very, very important topic for this time. The next is Kachnar leaves, which is again important. The rampant use of antibiotics, which has been covered for more than 3-4 editions of Down to Earth, is again important. And the various toxics or the insecticides that are being used to control the locust and the biocontrol methods are again important. We would be covering many interesting topics in Down to Earth. So stay tuned. Have a wonderful day ahead.